This is a Bentley Arnage, and it is the most luxurious car you can get for 30 grand. Yes, that's right, I'm standing here next to a modern Bentley. This car hasn't even been off the market for 10 years with modern performance numbers. This one has 460 horsepower and 650 pound-feet of torque, and I'm telling you that you can get it for 30 grand. This is going to be a fun video. I've borrowed this car from a viewer here in Los Angeles, and I'm gonna tell you how you can get an Arnage like this one for under 30 grand. Simple, just go on Auto Trader, search for Bentley Arnages, and boom, there are a lot available. Right now, as I film this, there are 18 Arnage models listed for under $35,000, including 5 Arnage T models like this one with more power than a regular Arnage. 30 grand for this stately, muscular Bentley. But you're thinking, okay, fine, but everybody knows used Bentley models are cheap. You can get those 1980s models for like 15 grand because they're always breaking down and the parts are 30 years old and they're hard to find and they're all crappy. But see, that's the thing about this car. This isn't an old Bentley. This is a 2002 model, and the Arnage was built all the way through 2009, which means it left the market less than a decade ago. This isn't just a cheap Bentley. This is a cheap modern Bentley, which means it's actually luxurious by modern standards and not just 1980s luxurious. And this is the one to have. The Arnage first came out in 1999, and the original models used a BMW V8 with 350 horsepower, and that was fine. But then the Arnage T came out in 2002, and it was a huge upgrade. 460 horsepower, 650 pound-feet of torque, and it did 0 to 60 in 5.5 seconds. Plus, this was the flagship Bentley model from the time. The Continental GT was a great car, but it was the one you drove if you were the president of the company. The Arnage is the one you drove if you owned the company. So today I'm going to take you on a tour of this Arnage T, and I'm going to show you all of the quirks and features of one of the cheapest ultra-luxury cars you can buy. And by the way, I think this particular Arnage is probably worth somewhere between $35,000 and $40,000 based on its good condition and the fact that it is the more desired T model, but it's still pretty cheap. Anyway, then I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the Arnage T, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also rounded up a list of the cheapest used Bentley models currently listed for sale on Auto Trader. Now, I'm going to start the quirks and features with the Arnage's doors, and specifically the fact that when you open the door, you quickly discover the door is tremendously heavy. It has that incredibly solid feel you associate with old school British luxury cars, and that's because the door is full of window and trim and leather and wood and aluminum, and it feels exactly how you'd expect the door to feel in a car with an original sticker price of over $300,000. Next up, we move inside the car, where there is, of course, a long list of quirks and features. Mostly features, including, I'm going to start on the door panel itself, where you can see this beautiful brushed aluminum trim. It looks very nice on the door panel, but it looks even better on the trim surrounding the gauges. Absolutely beautiful piece of trim, and it was probably something like a $20,000 option back when it was new. Still looks good 15 years later. Now next, I'm going to move up to the ceiling, next to the mirror up here, where there are a couple of interesting items, one of which is the reading lights. You can turn on the reading lights in this car by pushing a little button. Not all that surprising, but the cool thing is you can move them. You can move them to exactly where you're reading, so you can use them to illuminate precisely the spot where you need to see. That's the kind of feature you expect from a luxury car. One other interesting item up there, you can see there's a little button that says I with an arrow pointing up. That button rises up the infotainment screen from the top of the dashboard. You push it and the screen rises up automatically. Although in this car, apparently it does it in a few stages, not that it matters. The owner, of course, told me he doesn't ever use the old school navigation system, but it's interesting to see a control for that mounted sort of in the ceiling next to the reading lights. By the way, one other funny thing about the infotainment screen is you can see there's no real way to control it because it isn't a touchscreen and there's no control here in the center control stack for it. So you're wondering, well, how do you do anything with it? The answer is this little remote control. This is a $300,000 plus car, and it was shipped with this ridiculous plastic remote with purple buttons, like a cheap TV you buy from Best Buy. It's crazy that this happened, but it did. And there's even a little remote holder built into the front door so you can store your remote when you're not using it. Now, next, moving on to the gauge cluster, one interesting item with this car is that it has all of its warning lights in sort of a vertical line in between the speedometer and the tachometer. And they're all a bunch of different colors. Although the thing that I like best, an Easter egg about this car that the owner told me, is that if you hold down the trip button and the cancel button while the key is in the accessories position, you can cycle through all the potential warning lights that this car has. Take a look at some of the warning lights. Most Arnage owners probably don't even know that their car will warn them of some of these things, but you can take a gander at all the potential warning lights if you hold down those two buttons, something probably most Arnage owners watching didn't even know about. Now, another interesting item in the Arnage is just how beautiful it is. Like I said, this car cost over $300,000 new, and a lot of that simply has to do with craftsmanship. Leather is everywhere. Bentley claimed it took 17 cowhides to make the leather interior in an Arnage, which is no surprise if you look around because every surface is leather, even the headliner, the visors, everything. But also aluminum is everywhere, and wood. There's very little plastic in this car. Some examples, the mirror controls are in the center console, and they're individual. You have one control for the left mirror, one control for the right mirror, and they're aluminum. That's a big upgrade from the mirror control in your car, which is almost surely plastic and has one little joystick for both mirrors. Then there's the cigarette lighter, something you'll barely ever use. Even that is aluminum, and it's very heavy. I wish I could show you this on camera, but you'll have to take my word for it. This is the heaviest cigarette lighter I've ever seen, even though it mostly lives behind a wood door and you never even see it. But to me, the most amazing one of these aluminum controls is the one for the gauge cluster brightness. Almost all cars have a little slider where you can make the gauges dimmer or brighter. In this car, that slider is one of these heavy, high-quality aluminum dials, and it's just incredible. I mean, this is something that you will only adjust maybe three or four times throughout the life of ownership of the car, and yet they made it nice. In fact, they made a concerted effort not to include any plastic basically anywhere in this car, and you kind of have to go on a hunt to find some, although there are a few plastic switches here in the center console. For example, the seat control is plastic. You can see it right here in the middle, driver and passenger seat. And then above that, there are plastic controls for the heated seats, and then my personal favorite, the seat memory. Why are there four settings for the passenger seat memory? Who needs four different passenger seat memory settings? It makes no sense, except they probably kept this whole piece for right-hand drive cars too, so then they didn't have to flip it. So they just figured we'll give driver and passenger four settings, and that way it works in both right and left-hand drive markets. One other interesting place where there are plastic buttons is the climate controls. And the reason for that is BMW fans will know instantly. They just took the climate controls right out of BMW. The Arnage was built at a time when BMW had a controlling interest in Bentley. So like I mentioned, the earlier Arnage models had a BMW engine, and even later ones had BMW switches for the climate control. Now, next up, in the vicinity of the climate vents, you have these five gauges in the middle for oil pressure, battery, fuel. Fuel is my favorite. In your car, it probably just says E for empty and F for full, but in this car, it spells out empty and full. Bentley does not do abbreviations. One other item in this little area of gauges, you'll notice that each individual gauge has a Bentley Flying B logo in it, not one for the whole group of gauges. Each gauge. Next up, opening up the glove box, there are a couple of interesting items in here. One is the clock setter, and it only moves in one direction. If you move it to the right, you move the clock up 1 minute. And so if you move it up a few times to the right, you're screwed. It won't move to the left and move the clock back. Instead, you have to go all the way around. Fortunately, if you hold it down, it moves relatively quickly, so you can do this in just a minute or so. But nonetheless, you'd think they'd make it a little easier to set the clock. but they don't. The other item in there is a trunk lock. You can switch on the trunk lock, and then valets won't have access to your trunk if you give this car to a valet. Next up, moving on to a few other interesting items in the interior, the center console. Now, if you open up the center console, you will of course find storage like you do in so many other cars. Although one interesting item, if you close the console and look at the lid, you can pull back the leather piece on the center console lid, and there's more storage in the lid itself, which is kind of interesting. But opening up the center console, you will find two rather interesting quirks. One is cup holders. Clearly, cup holders were an afterthought in this car because, you know, they put them in the center console. So if you want your drinks, you got to open the console, put the drink in, and then just hope the console doesn't fall and knock over the drink and spill it everywhere. That is, of course, very bad design. The other interesting item in there is the fact that there is a DVD slot in there. I guess it's for navigation or whatever. The interesting thing is not the slot itself, but the fact that when it isn't in use, you can cover it with a piece of leather. So that means if you want to load a DVD into this slot, you climb into your leather interior, you open up the leather center console lid, and then you peel back the leather covering on the DVD slot. No wonder 17 cowhides were used to make the interior of this car. The other rather surprising item is the transmission lever. It's a very cool look, this aluminum post with this black leather ball on top, but you'll notice that there are no buttons to shift into gear. So how do you do it? Well, in order to shift into reverse in this car, you have to lift up the ball on top of the shift lever. The owner told me this has the effect of confusing valets everywhere, since it's not exactly intuitive how you get it into reverse. Next, we move on to the rear of the Arnage, which is a beautiful, wonderful, luxurious place to spend time. And that's made clear the moment you step inside and realize you have picnic tables that come down from the front seats, and they have that same beautiful aluminum finish on them that you have on the door panels and the gauge cluster shroud in front. It is absolutely gorgeous. Even though no one will ever use these picnic tables, the attention to detail is very much appreciated. Not as much appreciated is the cup holders in back, which are almost as much of an afterthought as the cup holders in front. You can see they come out from the back of the center console, and they're so tiny and crappy, it's like they weren't actually designed for cups, but just to placate some design requirement. You know, you gotta have cup holders. Fine, we'll give them these. With that said, the cup holders do have sort of an interesting folding mechanism built into them when you push them back into their home. First, the part closer to you folds, and then as you push, the other part folds on top of it, probably some vastly too complicated an expensive piece of BMW German engineering. A couple of other interesting items back here. One is the fact that the rear seats in this car adjust. You can move them forwards or backwards depending on your precise desired seating position, which of course is unusual in a car with a rear bench seat, but not in a Bentley. Another interesting item, you can drop the rear center armrest, which is of course a giant piece of leather with a nice leather hoop that lets you let it down. Now, one thing I absolutely love about this rear center armrest is that when you open it, you can see the latches that are keeping it closed. Bentley didn't just go with one single latch in the middle, although there is that latch, but they also followed it up with two supplementary magnets on both sides of the center latch. They just wanted to make sure that it would stay closed and it wouldn't rattle. Everyone else would have just stuck one single latch back here, but that's not what you do when you're making a $300,000 car. Next up, a couple of other excellent touches in the back of this car. One is the floor mats. These aren't just regular old floor mats, but rather they have this thick feel to them. You can take off your shoes and just plop your feet right onto them, and you'll be so comfortable. It's just wonderful. Another nice touch back here is the rear reading lights operate just like the front ones do, in the sense that you can move them to your desired position. That means if you're being chauffeured around in your Arnage and you want to read the Wall Street Journal, you can adjust the light to precisely where you want it in order to read the article about how you're purchasing three counties and all of the people in them. Next up, moving on to the trunk, there are a couple of interesting items with the trunk, starting with simply opening it. Now, like most cars, you can stick your hand under here, press a little button, and that pops open the trunk, and you can open it from there. But My favorite thing about the trunk is what you do if you want to open it with a key. In order to do that, you walk up to the Bentley B logo, you move the B out of the way, and then there is a hidden keyhole, which is a really cool piece of design. But anyway, you open up the trunk, and you will immediately notice there are two rather interesting items in here. One, there is a severed head, which is obviously uncommon in most Bentley models, but this particular one has it. Another interesting item back here are these two Bentley umbrellas, finished in beautiful British racing green. They just sit back there in the trunk waiting to be used, or perhaps more appropriately, waiting to be accidentally left in a restaurant, and then you go on eBay and look for another one, and it turns out it's like $900. So you want to keep those right there in place. Now, next up, you can see the trunk is nicely carpeted, and most Arnage owners will probably never go beyond here. They just throw their stuff in, they have their umbrellas, maybe their severed head, and they just move on with life. But if you open up the trunk lining, pull it up, then you can see a couple of rather interesting quirks of this car. One is the fact that this piece on the bottom underneath the carpet has a clip on it. And as you can see, if you clip it to the rubber trunk liner, you can then have it just sit up, and then that gives you better access to all of the items underneath the trunk carpeting. So what exactly is underneath the trunk carpeting? Oh, it's an interesting one, starting with the fact that they give you bulbs. I guess for like roadside turn signal changes, if your signal goes out, they even give you gloves so that you can pull over and stop your Arnage in order to change your signal bulb. To me, that's just absolutely crazy. By far the strangest thing though about the piece underneath the trunk, they give you all these little replacement items and tools. That includes extra batteries. That would be for the infotainment system remote controller. When the batteries finally died in that, you went under here and you had extra batteries. Of course, you could also just go to like any store and get new batteries that weren't 10 years old by the time those batteries finally died, but just in case you couldn't figure that out, Bentley gave you some extras in your trunk. That, to me, is just absolutely crazy. Next up, a couple of other interesting items back here. One is the fact that when you go to close the trunk, you don't have to just slam it because there's an electronic trunk latch. So when you get it down to the lowest position and close it, the car will do the latching for you. Also interesting, in the back, you have on the C-pillar the fuel door, which is kind of an odd place for a fuel door, but that's where Bentley puts it, not on the fender, but higher up. Maybe the stranger thing about the fuel door, though, is the fact that the door itself opens from the top. It's hinged on the top rather than on the side like the fuel door in almost every other car. One other item I absolutely love in this car is the wheels. I think the wheels in the Arnage T, which were unique to this model, are absolutely gorgeous. They take this beautiful, stately, old-school design, and they kind of telegraph to people who know that there's some muscle under the hood. I think it's a really, really cool look, a great wheel design for this car. And so let's talk about this car's power. This is Bentley's 6¾-liter V8, which, like I said before, 460 horse, 650 pound-feet of torque, absolutely massive numbers. And there are a couple of interesting items when you get into the engine bay. One is the fact that there's a wide range of warning labels explaining stuff, which surprises me. Usually you'd find these explanations in the owner's manual. It's rare that you open an engine and have so much stuff telling you where things are and what you have to lift up to access things. It's almost like they expect the person working on this car not to know how to do anything. One interesting item I really like on the engine is the fact that you have the plaque signed by the person who built the engine. Now, a lot of cars have this. Often it's just a little plaque stuck on the top of the engine, or maybe it's stuck on the plastic around the engine. But in this car, it's actually like cast into the engine itself. You can't remove it easily or really at all, and it also includes the engine number of this specific car. It's a very cool little plaque, one of the first things you see when you open up the hood. And so, those are the quirks and features of the Arnage T. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the Arnage T. Now, I want to say one thing about reliability, because reliability is sort of a famous sticking point for these cars. You know, it's an old Bentley, it's cheap, but it's probably crap, right? Well, the owner has told me he's driven this car like 35,000 miles. He's owned it 10 years. And he says it's actually been fairly reasonable to own. He says it costs him maybe $1,000-$1,500 a year maximum between maintenance and repairs. He said it just hasn't been all that expensive, to which he has been surprised. Now, I actually worked at a Bentley dealership 10 years ago, back when this was just ending its production run. Couple interesting things about them. One is the red line in this car is 4,600 RPM, and in fact, the tach only goes to 5,000. These cars were geared for ultra low end torque and power, and you won't see a red line like that except basically on a diesel pickup, but that's how this power plant worked. Something else I've always loved about this car, just the appearance of it. This car just looks boss. There's no car that looks more mafia boss than this one. It's just fantastic, especially the T with the T wheels in black. This is the right Arnage. Whoa! It doesn't get going incredibly immediately. It takes a second, although I'm told if you put it in sport mode, the shift points change a little bit and it gets a little faster. But once you get going, it just keeps building and building and building, as Bentleys do. Just getting going, you hear that big V8 going and rumble, and you're just, oh yeah. Steering is monstrously light, lighter than just about any car that you'll use. It's actually almost impressive how light it is. And as a result, you're not really connected dramatically to what's actually happening with the front wheels. This is certainly not an athletic car. These things weigh like 6,000 pounds or some ridiculous number because of all the leather and the wood and the electronics that are in these cars. They're old school vehicles, old school construction, and just massively huge. And so the result of that is that it doesn't, you're not gonna throw it around. I mean, even though if you throw enough power at something, it'll go fast, but it's hard to fight the physics of, you know, the turning and stopping and that sort of thing. And so this doesn't feel like a sports sedan. Oh man, even just mid-range throttle, it just hauls and hauls. It's just ready to go. The amazing thing is just how quickly it's able to move a vehicle of this heft. One impressive thing about this car, of course, is the ride quality. I was just talking about how light the steering is and how it's not really a sports sedan, but the benefit is it does feel like a true full-size luxury sedan. And so even though you go around a corner and there's a lot more body roll than you'd want in a sports sedan, the benefit is I go over these road bumps and it just feels like 10 times more comfortable than my AMG station wagon.
And so that's the Bentley Arnage T. Yes, we all know that used Bentley models can be cheap, but this one is an exception. A Bentley with 460 horsepower and 650 pound-feet of torque that has modern luxuries and amenities and features that you can buy for the price of a Toyota Camry. Of course, it might cost you a Toyota Camry a year in maintenance and repairs if you plan to drive it a lot, but never mind all that. Now it's time for the Doug score.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Arnage T is handsome, but obviously not supercar gorgeous. It gets a 6 out of 10. Acceleration does 0 to 60 in 5.5 seconds, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Handling is about what you'd expect, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Fun factor is decent for a big sedan, though not anywhere into sports car territory, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Cool factor is okay. These are stately, but word has gotten out about how cheap they are, and they don't quite turn heads like they once did now that some people are buying them cheap and maintaining them cheaper. Still, it's an impressive car, and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 26 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features, and the Arnage has decent technology for its day, though it's way behind the times now, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Comfort is excellent, though the T model's sporty flair takes it down a notch from a perfect score to get a 9 out of 10. Quality is excellent, though reliability is certainly a worry, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Practicality is average for the class, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Finally, value, and it's hard to give this car anything other than a pretty high score. Yes, it will be expensive to own, but it's still a flagship Bentley luxury sedan with good power for very little money, and it gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 32 out of 50. Add it up, and the Doug score is 58 out of 100, and here it is compared to a mixed bag of luxury cars. New stuff does better, of course, but the Arnage beats out lesser luxury cars from its era, like the BMW 750iL. Maybe most noteworthy is that it ties the Kia K900 and the Lincoln Continental, both of which cost more to buy, but probably similar to own, and if you're looking for a luxury sedan, it might be worth asking. Would you rather pay 60 grand for a K900 or a Continental, or pay 30 for an Arnage and roll the dice on reliability? I'll leave that one for you to answer.